you end up with this u y x minus gamma a 0 x y is approximately some constant with the function of this constant. So okay, capital. It's something a k 0 square c d, because we have it's formula still here or not. Yeah, we have k 0 square here, and we have minus a c d, so we'll have minus something like this. And then we will have the sum on rd minus 1, the sum on y smaller than rho, sum on y, okay, dy beta alpha, look at this coefficient here, and then this exponential, I wrote it down here, e beta alpha xd minus yd plus x tilde minus y tilde, or d tilde, this is d, and dd. Okay, and you have another contribution, you have this plane wave here, because I assume that the source is far away. So I assume that the source is far away, but the receiver could be at finite distance from the inclusion, from that act. So you have exponential minus a k0 y over y times d. Okay. Good, and this is sum on this. Sum on z, it's in the support. It's on this. Okay. So this is, if you look at it, this is nothing else than the Fourier transform. Okay. So what do you do? Let me write it more simply. Let's assume that y over y is the vector 0, 1. Assume d equal 2, we are in two dimension. So this is measured data. We have the targets here, and the field is incident from here. Okay. We have incident field here, we have the target, and we make measurements on this line. This is 0, 1. Okay. So this is, I will take x2 equal to L. I make measurements at the distance L. And you take this one at this line x equal L, and you can write it approximately using this formula. It's a sum constant minus infinity plus infinity d alpha, sum on d less than rho, this is this, rho is the size, look at z in d, okay, vg, beta alpha, and exponential a beta alpha, let me write it here, l minus y2, plus alpha x1 minus y1, okay? And you have this one is nothing else than exponential a omega y2, z2, dz. So y here is z, okay. So you can write it, so beta alpha, I'll write it again here. So the data is approximately the sum minus infinity infinity d alpha. And now you recognize the Fourier transform of V. So d alpha V, I will call it to be V hat of alpha beta alpha minus omega and exponential E. What is left? So you take Vg here. You take this one. You take this one. So V hat would be the integral of Vg on the d of exponential A beta alpha times minus d2 plus alpha d1. And this is dg. And this is Fourier transform. Okay. And the other one, you keep L and you keep alpha x1. So L is a constant. So you can get rid of it. So E A beta alpha L, okay, plus alpha x1. And you integrate over the alpha. So this is Fourier transform of the potential. But this is, if you take the Fourier transform of the data with respect, this is the Fourier transform of the data. If you take the Fourier transform of the data with respect to x1, you will get this one. Right? Or the inverse Fourier transform of the data with respect to x1. So you take this is the data as function of x1. We take its Fourier transform. It's some constant times the Fourier transform of the potential. So the Fourier transform of the data data hat in the variable x1 is equal to some constant the Fourier transform of V of V, so I call it V hat in alpha and square root of omega square minus alpha square minus omega. So in some point, okay, you make the Fourier transform of the data, you get the Fourier transform of the potential, but at some coordinate. Now, what you do? So you eliminate the target from here. And you measure it here. You rotate. You eliminate the target from here. And you measure in the perpendicular line. And then you eliminate from here. And you measure here. You eliminate from here. You measure. So you will get V hat on this thing. On this disk. And then you reconstruct the low pass version of V. So this is diffraction tomography. This is tomographic system. Because you are not making the measurement at infinity, so you cannot simplify this by this one and apply the Fourier transform of V to get and apply the Fourier transform of the far field measurement to get to get V. You have to do it at a finite distance, but at finite distance, you relate the Fourier transform of the data on this line to the Fourier transform of the potential at some point. And then you rotate, and you get your potential. And you get a finite resolution. Resolution is exactly this Rayleigh limit. Because of what? Because there is no way to... no way to extend. Actually, it's an analytic function if you think about it. And analytic function, it's enough. If you know it here, then it's enough, mathematically speaking, to know it everywhere. But there is no way to make it in a stable way. So, because analytic continuation is the worst, is exponentially ill-posed. So you can try to make it with analytic continuation, it would be a disaster. So just make it with zero. You don't know the data, make it with zero, and then you get what you get. And you get not resolved, but low pass filter. If you try to make it with analytic continuation, you will get, resolved version, but you will lose stability. Very quickly you will be, it will be completely unstable, and then what you get, it doesn't make any sense. So now let me, so this was at zero frequency, at single frequency. And if you think about it, frequency is here. So k0 is, this is 2 omega square root of epsilon mu 0. So if you have measurements for fixed frequency, this disk is fixed. But if you have it for every frequency, then this disk will be not fixed. Will cover the whole plane. If it covers the whole plane, you cover the Fourier transform of the potential everywhere. Then you get infinite resolution. Makes sense. If you have all the frequencies, measurements for all the frequencies, then you can do the same for single frequency. You will get the Fourier transform here, but the size of the disk is function of the frequency. Then getting making the frequency higher gives you better resolution. And if you have all the frequencies, you have infinite resolution. Okay? In practice, you don't have all the frequencies. You have some range of frequencies, so your resolution is with the highest frequency. Okay? Because you get the largest disk. And this is what happens with, I think it's exactly the same idea. This is what happens with time reversal. So with time reversal, you will have infinite resolution because you have time domain measurements. Time domain, take the Fourier transform of the time domain measurements will give you the frequency domain for all the frequencies. Okay, so you get infinite resolution. So what's time reversal? Time reversal is you make the measurements in the time domain. So you generate your wave here. It hits the target. You collect the signal. This is what I explained. If it's small, then the signal behaves like a dipole source at the location of the inclusion. And then you collect the data and send it back inside the medium. If the target is small, it will focalize on the target. If it's extended, not. But if we are in this Born approximation, so if we approximate the target by source term, even if it's extended, it will focalize. You will get a perfect image. So let me do it. No question for this diffraction tomography? So you take the same configuration. And you take measurements are now coming from source term. Source term is modeled by V, the potential V. Okay. So it's dt minus Laplace nu is equal to direct mass at derivative of direct mass at t f of x. So f of x would be for this Born approximation. F of x would be what? Would be V times the Green function. Okay, so let me assume it independent of the type. Okay, I have a source term f of x. Yeah. So this would be my target. At t before t equals zero, nothing happening. And at t equals zero, wave coming from F is propagating. Coming from the support of F is propagating. Okay, this is u. I will collect the signal on some boundary d omega. I measure u on the boundary d omega for x and t. X is on d omega, and t is from 0 to capital T. So capital T has to be large enough, because capital T would be the travel time from the support of the source to the boundary. So T would be large enough. For T small, capital T small, there is no signal here. It's propagating, the solution is with finite speed of propagation. So it needs some time to reach the boundary. Okay? So at t small, nothing happening. Then I will collect from some time t minimum. I will start to collect something on the boundary, and after some time t maximum, the wave will go out. Okay, it's propagating in infinite domain. Now I collect this data. I call it g of x and t, and I would like from g to reconstruct f, let's move on, say y, to reconstruct f of x. Here x is on the omega and y is on the boundary. From the data, from what I measured, I would like to reconstruct my source term. Okay. So how to do it? The statement, the formulation of the problem is clear. I have pulse at t equals zero, starts from here. Okay. If you take f equal Dirac mass, it's starts from some point, and it's just a spherical wave. Okay. If it's distributed, then every point inside is generating a spherical wave. Okay. I'll collect the signal, and I would like to reconstruct f. So let me introduce a couple of things. So let me introduce the time-dependent fundamental solution. So I will call it gamma of x and y and of 2 and t. And this is, I will take it just the Fourier transform, 1 over 2 pi sum on R of the fundamental solution of the Helmholtz equation at x and y, exponential minus a y 2 minus t minus 2 d omega. So this is Fourier transform of this guy. Is the gamma is defined as the Fourier transform of the solution to the Helmholtz equation. Which satisfies the addition condition at infinity. Sommerfeld. Radiation condition at infinity. Take its Fourier transform. Let me look at what this guy is satisfying. It satisfies I take its second derivative with respect to time, minus Laplacian, it would be minus Dirac mass at y, or the other way, and Dirac mass at 2. If I take its derivative with respect to let me write it here. So it satisfies the wave equation with delta function in x and delta function in 2, in t. Okay. It's this is a pulse at t equal 2 generated at the point x equal y. Okay. This is the fundamental solution of the wave equation. And it satisfies gamma x y to t equal d gamma d2. This is an R in Rd. And nothing happened before the time t less than 2. It's causal. Gamma. It's causal. Or it's an outgoing wave. And it's outgoing because of this Sommerfeld radiation condition. If I change the Sommerfeld radiation condition from psi, this is a derivative minus A omega behaves like O of 1 over x to the power d plus 1 over 2. If I change this sign from minus to plus, I will change the outgoing, this wave from outgoing to incoming. So the wave will not be outgoing from y, it will be incoming, okay? And from causal to anti-causal. Causal means nothing happened because before the cause, because before this this Dirac mass, the pulse at t equal to 2. Nothing happened, it's zero. Okay, anti-causal is nothing happened after. Okay, so this is the causal Green function. Now, time reversal is there are two versions of time reversal. Perfect and approximate. So perfect time reversal and approximate. So perfect time, perfect time reversal or approximate time reversal. And I will show you what's the difference. So what's perfect time reversal? Perfect time reversal is solving. You solve the wave equation. So you collect this data, G. This is your data. You collect the data for y on the boundary of your sphere. So this is sphere. And from t, from 0 to capital T. You collect this data. And then time reversal, the data is just to send it back in the medium. In chronological, anti-chronological order, which the one arrived late will be the first going inside the medium. So you solve, mathematically you solve just the wave equation inside omega. You solve the wave equation with Vx at t equal 0 equal dt Vx at t equal 0 equal 0, and Vxt is equal to Gx t minus t. T minus t is you reversed the wave. Okay? And you solve the wave equation, you solve it inside the domain omega. Okay? You solve it. And then the imaging function would be A time reverse 1, called perfect, of x would be v of x and capital T. So you reverse the time here, you solve the equation, and at time capital T, you take the picture of the domain. Then this is would give you f of x. I will show it to you in omega. The picture at time capital T would give you the perfectly f of x. Okay. Solving this this is wave equation inside the bounded domain means that you need the Dirichlet green function. If you want to solve it, you need the Dirichlet green function. Because of what? Because of this boundary condition. You solve the boundary condition, this one, in d omega times 0 t. So you need the Dirichlet green function of your domain, okay, of the wave equation inside this bounded domain. But you, from time to time, it could be complicated. You don't want to compute it. Okay, so you approximate the Dirichlet green function with the fundamental solution, free space fundamental solution. So A2, so let me write what is the Dirichlet green function, and then I will write what is A2 time reversal of x. This is would be the same, but using not the Dirichlet green function, not solving the problem, approximating the solution of this problem. Okay, approximating the solution of the problem, the solution V, by replacing the Dirichlet green function by the fundamental solution, which one is gamma. This one. Instead of using the green function, you use gamma, which is explicit. That one is explicit. That one is in 3D. It's we computed delta t minus 2 minus x minus 1, something like this, right? Is that true? This is in dimension 3. It's a front wave propagating on this sphere. It's solution to that one. Okay. So instead of using the green function, you don't want to use the green function, you use the fundamental solution, and you get approximate time reversal. And this approximate time reversal would be, this is what I would like to show, approximately f of x. So you get the approximation of the image using free space green function, which is better. Okay. So let me show you how it works. So, in order to write integral representation of V, the solution to the wave equation inside the bounded domain, we need the Dirichlet green function. But there are two for the wave equation. There is the causal one and the anticausal one. There is no radiation condition here, so we cannot select the green function we have to use. For that one, we know the wave has to be to go outside. For bounded domain, you have reflection. You generate wave, it's reflected, and then it comes inside because of the boundary, because of the boundary of the domain. It's reflected by the domain. Okay, so inside the domain, you have two green functions, one which is going outside and one which is getting inside. So wave equations is tricky actually in bounded domains. So let's assume introduce G causal. So G causal would be what? Would be solution to the wave equation equal minus delta xy, same as delta 2t in omega, with starts from zero because it's causal. So x, y, 2t equal dt gs g causal. X, y, 2t equal zero for t is less than 2. And it has, so this one is like the causal one here, but it has to satisfy the boundary condition. So the new thing is GC for X, Y, 2T. This is zero for X on the boundary. Or I fixed Y here. For Y on the boundary. And for any T. Okay. This is boundary condition. This is extra condition compared to gamma. And because for the reflection from the boundary, we need to handle the anticausal. Anticausal is the same equation. This is R. Dx y d2t on omega times R. Anticausal. It has to satisfy similar boundary condition, similar initial conditions, anticausal, x, y, 2, t. But this is holds for t larger than 2. It's anticausal. Okay? And the boundary condition is Ga, x, y, 2, t is equal to 0 for y, the boundary, and for any t. Okay. So we have two fundamental solutions, and there is a symmetric one. Symmetric is the sum of the two. G symmetric is one half GA anticausal plus the causal one. So anticausal, it's non-zero. The anticausal is non-zero for t larger than 2. So, and the other one is 0 for t larger than 2. And for t smaller than 2, this one is non-zero and the other one is 0. Okay. So actually, okay, let me get rid of GA plus GS. And if you think about the equation satisfied by this one, it satisfies this equation. Minus delta GS equal to minus delta X Y delta 2 T. And you have GS Y 2 T equal to 0 on the boundary. This equation is on omega. Okay. It satisfies this equation. It satisfies the wave equation with boundary condition. And you don't have this causality condition or anti-causality condition because you make the sum. So this one, you can use it to represent the solution. So V would be nothing else than V of X and T. V of X and T would be capital T, would be the sum on 0 T, the sum on D omega, and DGS, D nu, Y, X, Y, T, S, G, Y, T minus S, DS, and D, D sigma y and ds. This is integral representation of the solution to this one. So how to do it? You just multiply by gs here, and you integrate by parts. Okay. So the solution v of at any time t is given by 0 to this time t, the convolution with the Green function. Okay. So without time, if you have, you don't have this one, the solution, as I said, it's a normal derivative of the Green function times g. This is a solution up to some sign. Now, v of x and t, you integrate with respect to time too. So you have 0 t. Okay. So, yeah, this is the data. Data is g of x t minus t, or t minus s, which I can make t here. Small t is better. And you integrate this state. You have v of x and t. Now, how to prove that this guy is f of x? Let's write what is the representation of g. We know what is g. G of y and s. G is coming from g is coming from this wave equation with source term f. It has integral representation too. See, g of y and s and integral representation is in terms of the Green function. Okay, so g is the data coming from dt du minus Laplacian u equal d dt f of x, and u and its derivative with respect to t equal 0 for t 0. This is the solution. And g is the u on the boundary. So in order to get integral representation of g, you multiply this equation by this this fundamental solution, and you integrate on x and on t. Okay, so you get g of y and s is equal, because of this derivative here, is equal to minus sum. Where is this one? Omega d gamma d dt of z y 0 and s f of z dz. This is your solution. Actually, this is u, and g is just u on the boundary. So this one, if you this integral here, if you apply second derivative of time minus Laplacian, you will apply second derivative of time minus Laplacian on gamma. But second derivative of Laplacian minus second derivative on time minus Laplacian on gamma is Dirac mass times Dirac mass. Then you will get Dirac mass convoluted with f, it's f, and the derivative of derivative of Dirac mass on time. So you get this one. U and dtu equals 0 for t negative, it's because of the conditions on gamma, the causality of gamma. So this is the solution. And g is nothing else than the solution on the boundary. So this holds for u, y in the boundary, and for s from 0 to capital T. Okay. Everyone agree with that? Now you plug in this one here. So you will get V of X and T equals the sum on T. The sum, let me put it in the other way. let's make it better, minus the sum of omega f d, the sum on 0t, the sum on d omega, g s d nu y, x y t s, d gamma dt, d y 0 t minus s, and now d sigma y dd. So just I put it to this one with s equal, here s is equal t minus t. So I will put it here, t, still t. That's all. This is the solution. Okay. But so we'll keep this one, but we want to prove that V is equal to F. We need to prove that this guy is nothing else than what? Delta X on Z. If we prove that this is a this is delta x on z, then we will get v is equal f, right? How to do it? We can use Parseval identity. This is convolution between two functions, right? So here we have t, and here we have t minus t. And we integrate over dt. Okay, so this is this is nothing else than. So it's nothing else than what? Taking the derivative in the Fourier space is multiplying by A omega. So this will give you, so this one. The sum on R using Parseval identity. This derivative in time would be A omega. Right? So this one, I will change it to normal derivative of GS Fourier transformed. Okay, and this one I will change it to Fourier transform of gamma. Fourier transform of gamma is gamma, the fundamental solution for Helmholtz equation. Okay, but I have t minus t, so it's Fourier transform conjugated. Okay, if you change t in minus t, you change the Fourier transform. F hat and F hat conjugated, right? So this one would be Fourier transform would be gamma frequency and D and Y. D sigma y. Is that right? And I have integral over d omega and have x, y here. So this is what I will end up with. I integrate over d omega on the variable y. It's here and here. Gamma omega bar, normal derivative of this guy bar, depends on the frequency. And that's all. It's very similar to Helmholtz-Kirchhoff identity. It's almost Helmholtz-Kirchhoff identity. So we can compute it actually. So that guy, we compute it. Can compute that the normal the integral on the boundary of a omega, and then I have to integrate on d omega. Okay, and on dd a omega. If I compute normal derivative of g omega s, I call it g omega s hat or without hat maybe. This is Fourier transform of this guy. G omega normal derivative, gamma omega bar. If I compute it, this is gamma omega of g of x minus g omega s of x and g. This is just integration by part, okay? Because this guy is solution to Laplacian plus omega square g s omega equal to Dirac mass and g s omega equal to zero. And the other one is solution to Laplacian plus omega square gamma omega equal to Dirac mass. So just to do integration by part, you will get normal derivative times this one minus g times the normal derivative. Must g is equal to zero, so we will get this cut. And okay, and then the because of the so this g s omega, it's is it real or it's complex? It's real. There is a unique solution of this problem. So we take bar here, the delta mass doesn't take bar, and the Biot-Mentel condition stays the same. So this is real. And this gamma omega is a real part plus complex part. And complex part is coming from the radiation condition. Okay. So if you take the imaginary part of this guy, it's the imaginary part of this guy. Okay, so here this guy and v of x and t, because f is we assume that f is real, it's real. So this one you can replace it by imaginary part of gamma omega, the same as okay, the imaginary part of gamma omega, and you have omega here. And if you compute what it is, this is Dirac mass. Okay, the integral. So you have the integral on R or on 0 plus infinity of omega imaginary part of gamma omega on 0 plus infinity, the frequency d omega. This is of x and g. This is Dirac mass on x of the function 0. Then you are done up to some psi. A1 is equal to f of x. This gives you perfect image because of this identity. Now I2 you do exactly the same. You do the same, and instead of ending up with a g, you will end up with gamma omega here. Gamma. And then if you take the Fourier transform, you will end up with gamma omega. But this, we know that this is Helmholtz-Kirchhoff identity. Okay, this is approximately the imaginary part of omega. So A2 of A2 A time reversal 2 of x would be approximately the same thing. Would be approximately omega imaginary part of omega. Okay? So it would be approximately minus sum of f d omega, sum on r, this omega imaginary part of gamma omega. And this is approximately, this is equal to f of d of f of x, because this is Dirac mass. So using the Green function, using the fundamental solution as an approximation of the Green function, gives approximately the same result. It is approximately the reconstruction of the source. Okay? And why this is interesting? Because we don't have to compute g here. Just we use gamma. So then we have imaging with the same resolution, but it's approximation. Some the amplitude is approximated, but the resolution is the same because of this Kirchhoff-Helmholtz identity. So this is what is going on when we approximate. We use the Born approximation to replace the target problem by inverse source problem. We have two ways of doing imaging. If the measurements are a single frequency, then we do diffraction tomography. And if the measurements are in time domain or are for broad range of frequencies, then time reversal is very natural. Actually, it's direct imaging. There is no iteration time reversal here. You get the F. And we get it with infinite resolution. And it's very stable. But we can prove that this is very stable. And in some sense, it's optimal. Okay. Now, if the target is not within this Born approximation, we have to realize the problem with respect to the shape. Actually, we can write the shape derivative of the multistatic response matrix with respect to the shape. We can write the perturbation induced by some changes in the domain with respect the changes of the multistatic response matrix with respect to changes in the shape. And using this shape derivative, we can do optimization. We cannot make direct imaging because it's a nonlinear, fully nonlinear problem. So we linearize the problem in order to make iterations. And then we have to iterate. Okay? And that you will see these notes that there is a notion of polarization tensor. Now, but it's x dependent. It depends on all the points on the boundary. So the polarization tensor for small inclusion, it doesn't depend on the shape. It depends on the shape of the boundary, but it's associated to the inclusion. For one inclusion, there is one polarization tensor. Here, when the inclusion is extended, for each point in the boundary, there is a polarization tensor. So actually, what you see in this multistatic response matrix, you see the contribution of points on the boundaries. Okay. And then the number, the diameter of the boundary over the wavelength gives you approximately the number of significant singular values of the matrix, approximately. Okay. And then you do this optimization in order to reconstruct. You need good initial guess. One initial guess could be obtained by high frequency asymptotics. So I was explaining that. When you are eliminating a target from here, this part is contributing, and you can get it in the high frequency regime, by making a Kirchhoff migration algorithm. So Kirchhoff migration algorithm will give you this eliminated part, which gives you good approximation. So you have symmetrize or whatever, and then start with this target, and then iterate using the shape derivative of the function to minimize the misfit between the multistatic response matrix computed and the one measured. Okay, so let me stop here. Hope that you like this lectures, and you learned something. I learned a lot in making them on Blackboard. Thank you.